I'm the compere for this book release function, and I'm both privileged and honored to be assigned this role. Let me begin by welcoming all our distinguished guests to this celebrated Darbar Hall, which has borne evidence to several momentous events in the nation's history. In fact, has been a witness to our nation's history in motion. And today promises to be no different. It would bear witness to yet another milestone in the nation's history, the completion of the 3 years of the government of our Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi, which has been witnessing drastic changes in all spectrum of life. And I will say no more except to say that we have been celebrating the changes which have been ushered in by the government of Honorable Prime Minister. And to celebrate it, two books that chronicle some of his most unexampled achievements would be released. The first book, Mann Ki Baat, A Social Revolution on Radio, is on the Honorable Prime Minister's direct engagement with the people and touching their hearts and souls using the entire spectrum of communication avenues. In view of my limited mandate, I will say that our Honorable Prime Minister, we have a leader who, for the first time, in ways more than one, has taken the government to the people rather than pause for the people to reach and search for the government. The second book is Marching with a Billion. It is a splendid narrative on the Honorable Prime Minister's achievement across the big beard of participative governance in all its hues and shades. It is an attempt to describe a leader in a hurry, a devout nationalist, a nation builder, and a leader who has touched and transformed the life of our nation like none other in independent India. With these few remarks, may I now request Srimati Omita Paul, Secretary of the Honorable President, to welcome this August gathering. Srimati Omita Paul.
It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to today's book release function, in which two books, Mann Ki Baat, A Social Revolution on Radio, and Marching with a Billion, Analyzing Narendra Modi's Government at Midterm, are being released, and their first copies being presented to the Honorable President. Ladies and gentlemen, as we all know, our Prime Minister is a communicator par excellence. Mann Ki Baat is his unique way of connecting with the masses and carrying on a dialogue with them, engaging with them on various important issues and seeking their feedback on improving governance. In 31 episodes till date, the Prime Minister has spoken on a range of diverse topics, such as gender equality, the need for cleanliness, education for all, best agricultural practices, and many more. The concept of Mann Ki Baat is a sterling example of participative communication, seamlessly integrating the modern and the time-tested traditional means of communication. He has given new currency to radio, which was a forgotten medium for communication for some time. It would not be an exaggeration to say that the Prime Minister, through Mann Ki Baat, becomes one with the people and reaches out to them in a manner which very few leaders in the modern world do. In the second book, Marching with a Billion, Shri Uday Mahurkar analyzes the performance of the present government on completion of 3 years in office. As I speak, the jubilant scenes from the Prime Minister and government swearing-in ceremony exactly 3 years ago flash vividly in my mind. These 3 years have been years of progress and movement forward in all areas of polity and economy. The Prime Minister himself has taken the lead to launch a transformative society, an agenda which is very forward-looking, encompassing programs such as Make in India, Digital India, Startup India, Skill India, and many more. The focus on financial inclusion and direct benefit transfers speaks volumes about his deep concern for the socially disadvantaged and his commitment to giving them a better future. I join all of India today in wishing our Prime Minister and the government Godspeed in their endeavors as they complete 3 eventful and achievement-filled years in office. With these words, I once again welcome you to today's function.
We are all delighted to be here at this very special program at Rashtrapati Bhavan to launch 2 very fascinating books. I'll talk about the first one. I remember talking about a radio program to Modi ji in April 2010 in my first meeting with him. I'm sure a lot of others did, which led to the first Mann Ki Baat program being aired in October 2014 on Gandhi Jayanti. The genesis of this book came a year ago when someone in our team came and told us, Mann Ki Baat has made Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji a guardian-like figure in every home. It is amazing how he has connected through that program to the soul of every Indian. That is when we started reading the transcripts more carefully and wondering, let's try and get a peek into the Prime Minister's mind on how he communicates during Mann Ki Baat. Hearing every episode again, in detail and in continuation, revealed some fascinating points. Mann Ki Baat has picked on many relatable themes that strike a chord with every Indian, rising beyond region, age, and interests. And here's a few basic sort of analysis that we found. The sector which had the highest mention was skill development and education, the 2 sectors, followed by matters relating to women and child welfare, as well as social upliftment and social transformation. Mann Ki Baat has remained a medium free of politics. From what I recollect, not even a single reference has been made to BJP in the programs. Even during the height of election campaigns, peak election season, there has been no politics on Mann Ki Baat. Cleanliness has come up in most of the episodes. This can be either lauding individual efforts, efforts by various communities, and by state governments. One of the strongest spirits of Mann Ki Baat has been a spirit of volunteerism, be it sharing details of a cleanliness initiative, efforts to prevent food waste, a selfie with a daughter for gender awareness, sharing photos of incredible India to promote tourism, doing things through which you can make a positive difference on people around and on the ground, and through which one can inspire others to make a difference. In fact, in the last episode, the Prime Minister urged students to get more and more people on the Bheem app. The 32nd episode will be aired this Sunday at 11 o'clock. And do you know that, in fact, after the English, Hindi version is broadcast, it is aired in various regional languages. Mann Ki Baat will always be remembered for its youth engagement, with topics that are very easily connectable to the youth, including an episode every year in the beginning for students appearing for their board exams. Let me tell you a little about the structure and format of the book. The book is divided into 2 parts. Part 1 has qualitative analysis of Mann Ki Baat, including how the name came about, the usage of radio before Prime Minister Modi ji, and then the various themes that Mann Ki Baat has touched: cleanliness, youth, outreach, women equality, tourism, safer roads, and so on. In this book, we have quoted extensively from social media, used people's tweets, and Facebook posts. The team working on the book also met with the Prime Minister with a series of inquisitive questions. And of course, as you know, he patiently answered all of them. Part 2 contains a definitive transcript. And we gave a lot of time to this because the content, as you will go through, has a timelessness about it. It's a ready reference for posterity. We feel generations to come should read about Mann Ki Baat and read the Mann Ki Baat. We have transcripts till September 2016. And in this age of mobile tech, At the end of every episode is a QR code, which you can use with your phone, and you'll be able to hear the entire episode. Thanks to the Narendra Modi app team, the book is linked with the app as well. Any feedback that people have on the book can be shared there. This book is academic and easy to read. It is comprehensive and concise. We have made it a quick and fun read, and we hope you enjoy it, and of course, share the feedback with us. Bluecraft Digital Foundation has compiled the book. Bluecraft has been set up by Hitesh Jain and me to help transform India using the power of digital, using data and technology. And on a side note, contrary to what your invitations say, I am not the author of the book. It's a team effort which has been helped put the book together. Special thanks to Dr. Hiren Joshi and Shri Yash Rajiv Gandhi for their insights, which were very helpful for the book. I also wanted to thank LexisNexis for publishing the book. And finally, a big thank you to our beloved Prime Minister, whose energy and enthusiasm never fails to impress and inspire. Thank you.
Marching with a Billion has an interesting story behind it. As I moved to Delhi in December 2015, at the behest of my editor and senior colleague at India Today, Shri Raj Chengappa, I was struck by one thing. As I moved around the corridors of power, I found there was a wide gap between the media perception of how the government was functioning and what was actually happening on the ground. I could sense that a lot was happening, but not much was traveling to the opinion makers. Or opinion makers were not willing to appreciate the work which was being done. First and the foremost, there was not much acknowledgement of the unprecedented transparency that the government had assured in top governance. And neither was there enough recognition for schemes like Jan Dhan and Mudra, which had large-scale impact for poor and common people in terms of their economic transformation. Of course, I could also see some of the shortfalls. But on the whole, I found a sincerity of purpose which was commendable. I saw ministers and bureaucrats working in office till late night to meet their stiff targets. I saw corridors of power that were now largely free from middlemen and deal makers. I also observed that Mr. Modi had elevated his stature after becoming Prime Minister. He had taken leadership to the next level. I could say this with authority, as I have seen his rise from a Prabhari to Prime Ministership from 1987 to 2017, and also having written a book on his Gujarat tenure titled Center Stage Inside the Narendra Modi Model of Governance in 2014. It was when I was observing these changes, my publisher and now good friend, Mili Aishwarya from Penguin Random House, reminded me of my promise that I had made in 2014. I had promised her that I'll write another book on Narendra Bhai's governance in Delhi when he becomes Prime Minister. As the offer came, I hesitated, as book writing is an independent pursuit and difficult to accomplish together with a full-time job. But Mili was persevering, and I had to relent. I learned many new things while writing this book. I should cite four things here. There is a constant pun on the bureaucracy for its alleged slow and unprofessional ways in many circles. But under the Modi administration, I found that the babus had transformed into drivers of governance. What mattered here was the right selection of the bureaucrats in terms of integrity, efficiency, and adaptability, which the government did by making changes in selection procedures. Selection of right bureaucrats is, I believe, one of the biggest reforms of the government that has gone unnoticed. The book throws light on it. The second lesson I learned was what a government can achieve when it appeals to the latent pride within the people. The government's interactive digital platform, where it invites ideas for governance, is a great example of that. Hundreds of suggestions out of thousands that have come during debates on MyGov have been accepted by the government and implemented. This has created a deep sense of pride in the people who came up with these ideas. I still remember how one medium-level Bengali IT professional originally a CPM supporter in Bengal, became an enthusiastic Modi follower when a logo designed by him was selected as the logo of Digital India. Thirdly, there was a talk of in the corridors of Delhi about centralization of power by the PMO. Here I found a very different angle. A government that is sincere in its approach and has kept high goals has the right to monitor the working of the government machinery under it. I think in this government, it is one of the main triggers of its success. Last but not the least, I thought the government should have been faster in disinvesting in loss-making PSUs, in keeping with its promise of maximum governance, minimum government. While being critical of this aspect, the book also gives the government view, which is not unconvincing. I must place here that I found the chapters on finance and foreign affairs very interesting. In both these areas, the government has brought great transformation. The GST and the burgeoning FDI are shining examples of it. The chapter on finance shows how the government has tried to save public money by plugging in the holes. The chapter on digital revolution and demonetization are equally interesting. I thank my publisher for giving me the opportunity to write what must be probably the first book on Mr. Modi's core governance. I must also thank my organization India Today, especially my editor-in-chief Arun Puri, Raj Chengappa, for allowing me the necessary flexibility to write the book. I must place on record here that when I wrote my first book on Mr. Modi in 2014, not many were willing to launch it, being unsure whether Mr. Modi would become the Prime Minister or not. It was Mr. Arun Puri who launched it at that time. He is not present here today due to a preoccupation. I am certainly missing his presence. I must also thank people in the MyGov, especially Akhilesh Mishra and Dr. Hiren Joshi, for facilitating this book. I got very good perception from it about the working of the government. I hope my book turns out to be a stepping stone to a better understanding of what lies ahead of India in future. Thank you.
Normally, when a government completes 3 years, there are mixed feelings. We've seen that in a life of an elected government, there is always an initial enthusiasm, which media colorfully calls the honeymoon period of a government. It's normally followed by the slog period, and when governments commit mistakes, it ends up with more challenging times, at times even revulsion. This has been a usual trend, and it requires quite an effort to beat that trend. And one of the reasons why the present NDA government led by the Prime Minister, as it enters its fourth year, keeps alive that sense of enthusiasm really is a matter for a research or maybe a future book itself. The country was looking looking for a decisive leadership. A leadership which could take even difficult situations in challenging times. And I think for future generations, this is going to be one of the lessons of the day, that you expect the world's largest democracy to have a leadership which has the courage to decide. And at times you take decisions which may not necessarily be very popular at first sight, which may be controversial, but then it can always bring much larger dividends to the country in the long run. And slowly, I'd use this phrase in my budget speech this year, the right cause never fails. That is what gets established in a democracy itself. And we saw this in the Prime Minister's capacity to take a decision, probably one of the most difficult decisions with regard to the demonetization of the high-value currency. I think besides the ability to decide and the courage to take difficult decisions, is a second challenge which a government has. And I think there is no more experienced a witness to this than the Honorable Rashtrapati Ji himself, who for almost close to 5 decades has been associated with governance. India needs to reform in order to grow faster from its traditional rates of 2%, 3%, which can't beat the poverty. It needs to grow faster. But when you try and reform after the enthusiasm of initial decisions, decision making becomes slower because a political contrarian argument begins that reforms have a political cost attached to it. How do you then blend the two? How does good governance then get blended with even competent politics? That becomes a challenge for any government. We've seen that happen repeatedly. And I think the Prime Minister found an answer in this, that the ability to reform, which makes the state richer because of buoyancy in the economy that comes, translate those advantages in favor of the poor. So if the poor feel that I am being directly benefited in terms of getting connected to a financial system through the world's largest financial inclusion program, if my village is going to get a road, if my village is going to get electrified, if my bank account is going to have a direct transfer of all resources itself, and I can see the advantage if I am going to get at state expenses a toilet attached to my house, then these are advantages which translate to the poor itself. And therefore, the blending of good governance with competent politics itself takes place. And I think the third experience has been that in order to govern effectively, governance must have a high value of credibility itself. And therefore, the normal temptation which politics and politicians have, that more and more power must be vested in us, you really have to divest yourself of that power, eliminate all discretions, which even with the best of intentions in the past have brought discredit to governments, and let an objective criteria, a market mechanism, decide, take various decisions. I think one of the first important decisions of the Prime Minister was that at least in matters of where commercial benefits are concerned, maintain an arm's length distance and divest yourself of all discretions and let the market itself decide. I think that pays dividend. And lastly, sir, I think communication in public life is key. Historically, if we see the portrait of Gandhiji hangs in the Darbar Hall, there has been no better political communicator than him that India has produced. The world and the Western media was mocking at him when he announced the Dandi Satyagraha. And he made it so simple that you just march and pick up a little salt, and that is all it requires to defy the British authority. And it sent an electrifying current across the country. So what was initially considered by many commentators in the media to be a maverick act proved to be a turning point in our history. That was the power of his communication, and I think we need to learn from that. Our media has become, and rightly so, extremely powerful. We saw the decline of the radio taking place. It was almost becoming a defunct medium. The FM radio revived it a little bit, and I think the Prime Minister spotted the strength of the radio itself. And the strength was not merely in communication. The strength was that merely giving an interview to half a dozen television anchors or addressing a ritual of a press conference in Vigyan Bhavan is not the art of communication. They are merely carriers of a message. Do you have the ability to go above their heads and talk to the people directly? And I think his experience in Gujarat, particularly from 2001 and 2 onwards, helped him in replicating that example, that talk to the people directly over the heads of half a dozen people who thought that they have a sole monopoly in conveying and communicating. And therefore, this experiment of talking directly to the people, he used radio as a medium. He used his political communications as a medium, just as the example of the Dandi Yatra that I gave, used that as a medium, and it proved to be a far more effective medium. And I think these are great lessons we've learned. And the fact that you've brought these lessons down in a book on the Mann Ki Baat, I think is quite commendable. I've had the privilege of knowing Uday Maholkar. He was posted in Gujarat itself for decades altogether, and has been a very close observer of the Prime Minister's political style. And I don't think there is anybody better than him who could have written on this particular subject. I compliment both of them for having authored these two commendable books. Thank you.
प्रधानमंत्री जी का ये जो अति लोकप्रिय मन की बात और इसका ये संकलित स्वरूप आज हमारे सामने है और दूसरी जो किताब है कि उदय माहौरकर जी द्वारा लिखित मार्चिंग विथ ए बिलियन एनालाइजिंग नरेंद्र मोदीज गवर्नमेंट एट मिडटर्म इस अवसर पर थोड़ा कुछ मुझे बोलने का आज अवसर मिला क्योंकि स्पीकर को बोलने का अवसर बहुत कम मिलता है और इसलिए मुझे बहुत खुशी हो रही है आज ये दोनों किताब महत्वपूर्ण है लेकिन मेरे दृष्टि से एक बात इसमें आती है कि देयर इज ए कॉमन लिंक बिटवीन दिस टू वी हैव ए डेमोक्रेसी रिपब्लिक ऑफ इंडिया हम कहते हैं और आजकल मुझे कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन भी कई बार पार्लियामेंट में सहारा दिया जाता है पढ़ो इसको या रूल बुक बहुत पढ़ना पड़ती है देखना पड़ती है तो जब ये कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन हम पढ़ते हैं देखते हैं तो पहला ही शुरुआत जो है वो है वी द पीपल ऑफ इंडिया हम भारत के लोग से इसकी शुरुआत होती है जब बात सरकार की आती है पॉलिसी की होती है योजना की होती है हम कहते हैं जनता के लिए पॉलिसी बनाई जनता के लिए ये बातें हमने अच्छी बातें की है योजना जनता के लिए है हम जनता को सरकार कुछ दे रही है ये भाव आते हैं और कभी कभी मेरे मन में आता है देन वेयर इज दिस वी द पीपल ऑफ इंडिया हम कहाँ स्टैंड कर रहे हैं पहले भी होती थी रेडियो पे बातें जो मैं देख रही हूँ नई बात नहीं है महात्मा जी भी करते थे या पंडित नेहरू करते थे बाद में इंदिरा जी के भी कई ऐसी बातें हैं कई बार ये होता था कि हमने आपके लिए क्या किया बैंकों का राष्ट्रीयकरण वगैरह वगैरह रेडियो से बताया जाता था या ये भी कभी कभी बताया जाता था कि नाउ ऑल ऑफ यू आर इन खुला जेल पूरा हिंदुस्तान जेल बन गया वो भी हो सकता था लोगों को बताया जाता था मुझे ऐसा लगता है जब ये जो हम गायब हो गया तो इस देश को लगा इससे मन की बात से कि ऐसा पहला प्रधानमंत्री इस देश को मिला है कि जो ये कहता है जिसने हमको अपनी बातों में विकास के नीति नियम कार्य सब भी इस हमको शामिल किया वी द पीपल ऑफ इंडिया इसको शामिल किया सबका साथ सबका विकास अगर जब बात आती है वो बात मेरी या तुम्हारी केवल नहीं ये हम सब की बात ये इसमें बात आ जाती है और एक बात जब हम बोलते हैं मन की बात ये मन की बात व्यक्ति किससे करता है मन की बात जो होती है उसी से करता है जो उसके सबसे निकट हो किसी ऐसे व्यक्ति से नहीं हम करता है जो हमें पसंद नहीं है या जिससे हमें बॉसिंग करना है नहीं करते जो हमारे सबसे निकट है जो प्रिय होता है या जिस पर हमें विश्वास है या जिससे संवाद स्थापित करने से हमें समान अनुभूति मिलती है अपनत्व का एक भाव भी जिसमें होता है और इसलिए ऐसा लगा कि प्रधानमंत्री जी ने ये जो माध्यम चुना है मेरा भारत मेरे लोग मेरे भारतीय या मेरे भारतीय दुनिया के किसी भी कोने में रहते हो और ऐसा लगता है इस सब मन की बात के पीछे ये पूरा का पूरा भाव मुझे कम से कम लगा एक सफल जननायक है, अच्छे मार्गदर्शक, वो अच्छा कम्युनिकेटर भी होता है। अभी अरुण जी ने कहा कि चाहे महात्मा जी हो, अपने क्रिया से कोई कुछ करता है, कम्युनिकेट करता है, लोगों को लेके चलता है। और इसमें ना केवल आम जनता की भावना आकांक्षा को समझता है, लेकिन अपनी भावना, अपने विचार, अपनी योजनाओं को जनता तक पहुंचता है, जनता की बात समझता है। ये टू वे डायलॉग जिसको हम कह सकते हैं, ये देखने मिलता है। हाँ, एक बात ज़रूर है, आज के सोशल मीडिया वाली, जहाँ सोशल मीडिया बहुत सक्रिय है, और इस युग में माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी ने रेडियो को माध्यम चुना, ये जैसे ही रेडियो को माध्यम चुना, मैं तो उस समय, हो सकता है मेरा केवल जन्म ही हुआ था, मगर मैं सुनती थी कि एक समय ऐसा था लोग कानों में प्राण लाकर के एक आवाज़ को पूरे दुनिया के लोग जहाँ भी हिंदुस्तानी हों सुनते थे, आजाद हिंद फौज, वो आवाज़ आजाद हिंद रेडियो, मैं सुभाष बोल रहा हूँ, ये होता। मैंने उसका अनुभव तो नहीं किया, मगर मैंने सुना है। तो रेडियो की बात इस तरीके से कोने कोने से सुनना, उसका फिर से अनुभव जैसे हो रहा है। एक बात अच्छी लगी है, पूरे टीम को मैं बधाई देती हूँ कि सभी विषय जो है इसमें, जो सभी विषय समयोचित विषय है मन की बात के, स्वच्छता अभियान हो, सेल्फी विद डॉटर्स, दिव्यांगों के हित, भ्रष्टाचार, अब मैं पूरे विषय नहीं पढ़ती, यू नो इट बेटर। बात केवल एक ही है, कुछ नए शब्द इसमें से उभर करके आए, जैसे दिव्यांग शब्द, ये भी एक ऐसा शब्द आ गया। मुझे याद है हमारे इंदौर में एक हमारे अच्छे विचारक है, एक बार उन्होंने मुझे कहा था, मध्य प्रदेश ने उस शब्द को अपनाया, उन्होंने कहा था, बार बार तुम बोलते हो सरकार भी, विधवा पेंशन, विधवाओं का कल्याण, विधवा विधवा शब्द, तो उन्होंने कहा, सुमित्रा जरा सोचो, ये जो विधवा विधवा बाल बार होते हैं, उसने अपना सौभाग्य गंवाया है, लेकिन परिवार में रहते वो सबके कल्याण की बात हमेशा सोचती है ये महिला, क्यों ना उसको कल्याणी कहा जाए। बहुत अच्छा शब्द निकल आया, लोगों से बात करते हैं तो अच्छी बात निकल आती है। मुझे लगता है ऐसे कई शब्द इसमें से निकल आए। अब सेल्फी विद डॉटर्स, बेटी बचाओ बेटी पढ़ाओ, कई सारी बातें हम करते, एक सेल्फी विद डॉटर्स एक पूरा संदेश गया। हालांकि ये सेल्फी के बारे में एक मेरी अपनी अलग धारणा है, सोचना पड़ेगा इस पर, क्योंकि ये सेल्फी इतनी हो गई है, चाहे जहाँ चाहे जाओ, और जहाँ हम जाते हैं सिर पे सिर लगा के सेल्फी लेने की बात होती है, मैं तो बहुत परेशान हूँ, तो मैं कई बार उसको टालती हूँ, मैं कहती हूँ, बाबा सेल्फी विद मोदी नॉट विद मी। लेकिन बात ये है कि एक कई शब्द इसमें से आते, आपने देखा होगा समयोचित, मैंने जब कहा तो विद्यार्थियों को जो संबोधन किया गया, बहुत सुंदर, एक भाव विभोर करने वाली बात थी, क्योंकि हम चिंतित रहते हैं युवाओं के लिए, परीक्षाओं के लिए चिंतित, ये चिंता को चिंतन में बदल देना, ये भी एक इसमें बहुत बड़ी बात है। और जब हमने देखा कि हम, कई बार मैं कहती हूँ, माता पिता भी अपने बच्चों को मार्क्स कमाने वाली मशीन बनाने में लगे हैं, कमाओ और कमाओ, इससे ज़्यादा प्रतिस्पर्धा का युग बहुत कहते हैं। और उसमें जब कोई प्रधानमंत्री विद्यार्थियों को कहता है, बहुत सुंदर उदाहरण देते हुए, कि प्रतिस्पर्धा नहीं अनुस्पर्धा करो, एक भाव बदल जाता है। तो कई बात मैं ये कहना चाहूँगी कि होता है माता पिता की बात गंभीरता से नहीं लेते, मगर देश का प्रधानमंत्री कुछ कहता है तब बात को एक गंभीरता आता है। तो स्वच्छता जैसी बात, कई बार मैं बोलती हूँ, हम बोलते क्रिमिनलिटी बहुत बढ़ रही है, ये बहुत गलत, वो बहुत गलत, और लगता है देश में अच्छे सोचने वाले बहुत लोग हैं, अच्छा सच समझने वालों का भी परसेंटेज बहुत बड़ा है। मैं हमेशा बोलती हूँ, जब हम बस में जाते हैं, सादे सफ़र करते हैं, क्योंकि मैंने किया हुआ है कई बार, तो होता है जो अगर 35-40 लोग बैठे हैं तो 5-7 लोग ऐसे मिलेंगे जो खिड़की के बाहर थूक रहे हैं, कुछ फेंक रहे हैं, बाकी 30 को लगता है अरे ऐसा ठीक नहीं, ये ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए, मगर इस बात को वजन नहीं प्राप्त होता। तो कहीं ना कहीं माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी ने स्वच्छता की बात कह के सबको समेट लिया, सबका इन्वॉल्वमेंट, ये कहीं ना कहीं इसमें आया। और लगता है ऐसा कि मन की बात के मूल में जन जागृति, जन भागीदारी, जन कल्याण की भावना निहित है, और फिर इस जन भागीदारी से विकास को जन आंदोलन का रूप दिया जा रहा है। और इसमें 125 करोड़ के ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा भारतवासियों की एक सामूहिक चेतना जागृत करके और उसके अंदर असीमित ऊर्जा को अनुप्रवाहित करके राष्ट्र निर्माण की भावना, ये सब कहीं ना कहीं ये मन की बात में आ जाता है। और केवल मैं नहीं कह रही हूँ, इस किताब को जिन्होंने फॉरवर्ड लिखा है, जापानी प्रधानमंत्री जी वो शिंजो एबे, उन्होंने कहा आई फाउंड पीएम मोदी कम्स नेक्स्ट टू नोबडी इन केयरिंग फॉर द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ हिज ओन कंट्री फ्रॉम इट्स स्ट्रेटेजी ऑफ ए लॉन्ग टर्म परस्पेक्टिव। ये इतना बड़ा भाव उन्होंने कहा। अब दूसरी किताब जो है हमारे उदय माहौरकर जी, अब इसमें थोड़ा सा समय हो सकता है क्योंकि ये मेरे अपने इंदौर के हैं उदय माहौरकर जी, तो मेरा अपना ये जो कोई कुछ भाव आता है ना, मगर सही बात है उदय जी, एक बहुत सामायिक और सामाजिक प्रासंगिक ऐसी किताब सामने लाने के लिए मैं आपको बहुत बहुत बधाई देती हूँ। इसमें प्रधानमंत्री के कार्यशैली का परिचय है, प्रधानमंत्री का परिचय नहीं, प्रधानमंत्री का कार्यशैली कैसी है, एक ईमानदार मेहनती निर्णय लेने वाला ऐसा कार्य प्रमुख और उसका पूरा मंत्रिमंडल कैसा काम करता है, इम्प्लीमेंटेशन मॉनिटरिंग कैसे करता है, ये सब बातें इसमें हैं। आपने 8 अध्याय में ये सब समेटने की कोशिश की है इसमें। और जनशक्ति का एकजुट होना, जनशक्ति पर भरोसा करना, ये वैसे बहुत आवश्यक है। ये सब चीज़ें एक प्रकार से ये आपके किताब में और जनशक्ति को जोड़ करके, पूरे उदाहरण देने की आवश्यकता नहीं, जनशक्ति को जोड़ करके हर एक का बैंक अकाउंट, डायरेक्ट पेमेंट इन बैंक अकाउंट, सब्सिडी छोड़ना, कई कई सारी चीज़ें ऐसी आएगी कि आप सब्सिडी छोड़ोगे तो दूसरे को मिलेगी, आप कुछ दे दो केवल सरकार आपको देगी नहीं, आपको भी इस समाज के लिए, इस देश के लिए देना है। ये हमारी संस्कृति है, वास्तव में हम भूलते जा रहे हैं, हमारे यहाँ कहाँ जा रहा है कि जीवने यावत आदायम स्यात् प्रदायम अधिकस्ततो, मिलने से ज़्यादा दे दो ये भाव है, तो सब्सिडी क्या चीज़ है, छोड़ो भाई, इतने साल बाद कोई ऐसा मिला और लोगों ने छोड़ दी, ये विश्वास आया। तो इट इज़ नेसेसरी, कई बार ये कहा जाता है, बड़े बड़े लोग कहते हैं कि गुड गवर्नेंस आप कहते हो उसको, प्रजातंत्र को अगर सफल बनाना हो तो, एक बड़ी व्यक्ति ने एक बार मुझे कहा था कि इट इज़ नेसेसरी दैट लेवल ऑफ नेशनल कॉन्शियसनेस ऑफ कॉमन सिटीजन मस्ट बी रेज्ड, एंड एग्जैक्टली वही कहीं ना कहीं करने की कोशिश है। कोई आर्थिक लालच नहीं, बजट को जिस प्रकार से रेल बजट, वास्तव में मैं कई बार सोचती हूँ, मैं भी सालों साल से पार्लियामेंट में हूँ, रेल बजट आता था तो हम बाकी कुछ नहीं देखते थे, वास्तव में हम कहते थे रेलवे हो या ट्रांसपोर्ट के साधन, ये सब धमनियाँ हैं हमारी, चलेगी अच्छी तरीके से तो विकास होगा, मगर हम पार्लियामेंट मेंबर क्या देखते थे, मेरे यहाँ कितनी गाड़ी दी, मेरे क्षेत्र में कितना पैसा दिया, तो और रेल भाड़ा तो नहीं बढ़ाया तो रेल बजट बहुत अच्छा, मगर एक समग्र विकास, ये जो बात इसमें दी, दोनों बजट एकत्रित करना, कई सारे महत्वपूर्ण निर्णय जो लिए गए देश की दृष्टि से लिए गए हैं, और इसको लोगों तक पहुंचाने की कोशिश हो गई है, लोगों को सम्मिलित करने के निर्णयों में कोशिश हो गई है। और एक बात ये और हो गई कि माननीय मोदी जी के नेतृत्व में डिजिटल टेक्नो रेवोल्यूशन हुआ है, एक प्रकार से ये डिजिटल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर खड़ा करने की जो कोशिश हुई, ये भी एक महत्वपूर्ण बात मुझे लगती है। और ऐसा लगता है कि आपके किताब में ही कहीं मैंने पढ़ा, ये बात भी सही, अरुण जी ज़्यादा अच्छे जानेंगे, कि पहला प्रधानमंत्री ऐसा है जो दिल्ली के लुटियन जोन्स के लुभावने कल्चर से थोड़ा बाहर, क्या है आप सब लोग समझते हैं, सब समझदार हैं, मगर एक सुव्यवस्थित तरीके से जनता में राष्ट्रीय गौरव जगाने की एक आंतरिक ललक उन्होंने पैदा की है और सबको साथ ले करके। तो मुझे ऐसा लगता है ये बात तो ऐसी हो गई, तुलसीदास ने जो कहा है, मुखिया मुख सो चाहिए खान पान को एक, पाले पोसे ही सकल अंग तुलसी सहित विवेक। और सभी मंत्री प्रधानमंत्री समेत एक गवर्नेंस की जो कल्पना इसमें की गई है वो मुझे लगता है इसको सामने रखकर के शायद बात हो रही है, कर रहे हैं। और इसलिए मुझे एक जो संवाद की कड़ी, दोनों के बीच संवाद की कड़ी और दोनों तरफ से पेपर, जो मैंने शुरू में कहा वी द पीपल ऑफ इंडिया, इनको साथ में रखते हुए ये जो कोशिश हुई है वो देश के भविष्य के लिए एक अच्छी शुरुआत है। यश जो है दिखेगा, कभी कम कभी ज़्यादा होता है, मगर जो शुरुआत है वो बहुत अच्छी, जो मन में भाव है वो बहुत अच्छी ऐसा लगता है। और ये केवल मैं नहीं कर रही हूँ, फिर वही बातें आपके पुस्तक में जिन्होंने फॉरवर्ड लिखा है, वो चेयरमैन जो है, फाउंडर एंड एग्जीक्यूटिव चेयरमैन ऑफ वर्ल्ड इकोनॉमिक फोरम, उन्होंने जो बात कही वही मैं समाप्त करती हूँ। इन माय कंजर्वेशंस विद बिजनेस लीडर्स, पॉलिटिशियंस, एकेडमिक्स एंड यंग पीपल फ्रॉम अराउंड द वर्ल्ड, इंडियंस एवरीवेयर फील डीपली एंगेज्ड, एनर्जाइज्ड एंड एम्पावर्ड टू पार्टिसिपेट इन प्राइम मिनिस्टर मोदीज न्यू विजन फॉर इंडिया। With such a decisive and strong leader, there is a great opportunity for Indians to participate in not only reforming but also transforming India responsibly and responsibly. दोनों बातें ये बहुत अच्छी तरीके से है। तो ये केवल ऐसा नहीं है कि माननीय प्रधान मोदी जी ने, प्रधानमंत्री या मंत्रिमंडल ने बहुत कुछ किया, प्रधानमंत्री जी ने सबको साथ में ले करके एक राष्ट्र निर्माण की तरफ जो मोड़ा है, सबके भाव साथ में लेके, दैट इज समथिंग ये दोनों किताबें कह रही है, ऐसा मुझे लगता है। आप सभी लोगों को बहुत बहुत सबका अभिनंदन करती हूँ और मुझे विश्वास है कहीं ना कहीं अभी तक हम जो चले तो है विकास के राह में, ये नहीं कहती किसी ने कुछ नहीं किया, मगर जो कुछ कोई कर रहा था उसमें एक स्ट्रांगली वी द पीपल ऑफ इंडिया को समाहित करते हुए जो काम हो रहा है उसको मैं सलाम करती हूँ।
दिस इज अ स्पेशल ओकेजन बाय वर्च्यू ऑफ इट्स सब्जेक्ट, इट्स थीम एंड इट्स वेन्यू। द टू बुक्स रिलीज हियर रिलेट टू प्राइम मिनिस्टर नरेंद्र मोदी जी। One is the text of his weekly radio broadcasts, the other a commentary to highlight its virtues. Both have been commented upon by previous speakers. I may add that on somewhat similar occasions in the academia, today's ceremony would be a conferment of an honor in absentia. Leaders of men and women necessarily feel the need to communicate with their followers in order to get the message across, generate enthusiasm, and repel doubts. To do so effectively, they need verbal skills. Some are born with it, others cultivate it. Success often depends on the occasion, the nature of the audience, and the right mix of logic, facts, and sentiments to exude a sense of authenticity. History abounds in instances of leaders moving crowds with the power of words. Semantics differentiates between an orator and a demagogue. Both speak to persuade. Both play on emotions. The difference is often subjective and depends on the trust reposed by the audience. An example of excess was the four-term American President Franklin Roosevelt, who once confessed to being a juggler whose left hand did not know what the right hand was doing and who was perfectly willing to mislead and tell untruths. The two books before us capture important facets of an important personality of our times, given its sophisticated multi-level dissemination and its large potential audience. Mann Ki Baat is an ingenious and influential communication platform created by Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji. It takes a traditional medium like the radio and marries it to the entire spectrum of communication technologies available, from television to the internet, from social media to mobile telephony. Mann Ki Baat has become an important element of Modi ji's direct to people communication. The strategy encompasses social media platforms like Twitter, the government's citizen engagement programs, My Government, and his personal app. A new complementary program, Jan Ki Baat, has recently been announced, and it would make the process increasingly interactive. I congratulate the authors and publishers for their effort in compiling these volumes. Jai Hind.
I am indeed very happy to have this opportunity of being present amidst you this morning to receive the first copy of two books, one on Mann Ki Baat and the other Marching with a Billion, to receive the first copies from the Honorable Speaker who released these books. Both Arunji and Sumitra ji have spelled out in details, along with the publishers, the contents of these two books, and I would not like to repeat. I would like to highlight only one point, that in a democracy, particularly in a parliamentary democracy like ours, at the interval of every 5 years, people get the opportunity to choose a government and more so choose a prime minister. We have followed the Westminster pattern, where this practice was established in the early 18th century, 1726, when Sir Robert Walpole was chosen as the first Prime Minister, and thereafter, over centuries, number of Prime Ministers have steered the government in 200 plus years of United Kingdom. after the French Revolution, there are different stages. US Revolution, they adopted the system of governance, which is essentially presidential form of government. At the interval of 4 years, in case of USA, from 1785 onwards, and in case of France, duration has varied, but system remains the same, essentially presidential. One striking feature you will notice of all the successful prime ministers, presidents will have to be a good communicator. Without having the capacity to be a communicator, how you expect to lead the millions of people to follow you, your ideas, your principles, your views, your approaches which you would like to have implemented within the period which has given to you? No doubt, in the contemporary period, Prime Minister Narendra Modi is one of the most effective communicators and perhaps can be compared with other illustrious prime ministers like Pandit Nehru or Mrs. Indira Gandhi, who communicated on their principles, on their ideas, accepting the parliamentary form of government and particularly to have a secular constitution after the partition and all the consequences. It was not easy. Unless 350 million people of the subcontinent were carried by Nehru to have the secularism as an essential ingredient in the constitution, to mobilize the huge public support in favor of the liberation war of Bangladesh, without effective communications, it would not have been possible to get the international opinion. Many of you may be aware of, but may not be aware of also. In the final stage, when the drama was being enacted in the United Nations, Security Council was to hold all major P4 countries, USA, UK, France, and England, United States of America, all four have agreed that there should be a ceasefire, immediate ceasefire between India and Pakistan. Date was 6th of December 1971. A veto was given by Soviet Russia, and the reasons which are given for putting veto, as quoted by the then Soviet representative in the United Nations, were a few words quoted from Mrs. Gandhi's speech in United Nations General Assembly. What she said there? She said in her long speech, in one portion she stated that if the internal policy of a country create a situation where 10 million people are forced to take shelter in a neighboring country, and in the context of out of 184 members of the United Nations, more than 80 members aggregate population will not be 10 million. If this is not the definition of aggression, I would like to know from the United Nations members, what is the definition of aggression? Exactly on that basis, Soviet Russia put its veto, and finally after 10 days, Bangladesh was liberated, a new nation came to exist. The short point which I am trying to drive at, communication is the most important power. I am grateful that this book has been brought out. Many people were eagerly listening to Prime Minister's Mann Ki Baat. Now they will have the advantage of all his speeches on the 31 occasions compiled together. And the subjects which he has chosen are truly affecting the life of millions of these people. There has been major developmental initiatives in different directions. It has been possible for India because of its strong foundations in economy to overcome the financial crisis and subsequently the international financial problems, including the Eurozone crisis. But Indian economy is moving steadfastly. Prime Minister has given a new direction, no doubt. Various initiatives which he has taken clearly indicate the onwards movement of India. Some of the decisions are no doubt epoch-making decisions. And people of India will get the opportunity through the compilation of his Mann Ki Baat, what reflected on him, to take a particular decision at a particular point of time and how determinedly he has pursued it. I wish both the publications should have very wide reading, not merely because it deals with the Prime Minister of the country, but because of the merit of these books, merit of its contents. I hope it will receive the attention of the readers, and I congratulate and express my gratitude to the publishers who have taken the trouble to compile, put it together, and has given their assessment of the leader who is leading this country. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
On behalf of Penguin Random House India, I feel deeply honored and privileged to thank you all for being here today. This is really a special occasion to mark 3 years of the Narendra Modi government with the release of two very unique books, Mann Ki Baat and Marching with a Billion. There is a lot of noise around us today, and sometimes it's difficult to make sense of it all. These books are an attempt to find the meaning, to scratch beneath the surface, and to venture outside newsroom studios. These books push the limits and boundaries of the conversations to include a wider national audience. Marching with a Billion presents facts and deep research about the Narendra Modi government and leaves the reader free to make up his mind. As a publisher, as I stand here before you all, I'm feeling a sense of deep pride and gratitude that a book has been released on this momentous occasion and here in this historic venue. My heartfelt thanks to the entire team of the Rashtrapati Bhavan who made this possible. But most of all, I'd like to thank my author, Shri Uday Mahulkar, for agreeing to write this book. Thank you for being so patient and open to most of my suggestions. Your passion, hard work, and self-belief is difficult to match. Like some other speakers have said before me, there couldn't have been a better author for this subject. So thank you for writing this book, Uday. I would also like to take the opportunity to thank Akhilesh Mishra from mygov.in and Dr. Hiren Joshi for providing us some rare pictures in the book and some data and statistics to enhance the content. I think the most important people actually are my team at Penguin Random House India, who worked relentlessly to make this book happen. Thank you, Sibani, Gunjan, Gulshan, Neeraj, Varun, it's a long list, Rukun. And last but not the least, our CEO, Gaurav Shinigesh, for his unwavering faith and solid support. Before I conclude, I must ask all of you to read the book after you've bought a copy and share your views with us. I hope you have a great day. Jai Hind.